One of the most interesting cases of eyewitness testimony that came out of the Phoenix Lights was a family who had witnessed the Phoenix Lights on March 13, 1997. Mr. and Mrs. Lee and their son Hal, who was 10 at the time, all witnessed the boomerang-shaped object pass over their house in great detail. Along with several other witnesses in their neighborhood, they were, as far as I know, one of the few documented cases of an entire family witnessing one of these events. I thought it was very important to show the world that these events are not just happening to individuals who are involved with black government projects and other types of situations. These events happen to people from all walks of life, from all age groups, from all ethnic backgrounds, from all countries, from all classes, and from all religious beliefs.
My name is Tim Lee. This is my wife, Bobby, and my son, Hal. Back in March 13th of 1997, we were witnesses to seeing a UFO, an actual craft, fly directly over a house. Just to give you a little background as to how we got to see it, Hal and I had been coming back from visiting some friends, and normally we tried to eat dinner by 8 o'clock. We were running a little late, pulled into the driveway, which we were heading west. Hal was sitting in the front, and as I came around to the side of the door, he looked out the side window, and he saw up in the direction of Prescott five distinct lights that it actually looked like they were on top of a balloon. As we were looking at them, I said, well, what is that? Is that a balloon with lights on it? Why would they have lights on a balloon like that? And, you know, the lights were so clear and distinct, and they were very close together. But as we watched them, then we could see that whatever this was coming towards us, because the lights, the distance between the lights started getting greater and greater. At that point, he ran in the house and got my wife, Bobby, to come out and take a look and see what was going on. So when Bobby came out, we're standing there watching. My grandson is older than Hal. He was also there. And we watched these lights. I'd say the time it took from when we first spotted them until this thing actually went over a house was about 10 or 12 minutes. And this thing never wavered once. It always came directly straight at us. As we were standing there watching it, after a few minutes, maybe 6 or 8 minutes, I'm not sure, all of a sudden, instead of being five lights in a round arc shape, that lead light seemed to come out in front, and now it looked like a V formation flying towards us. I remember talking with Bobby as we were watching it. We were saying, what could that possibly be? And I said, well, maybe it's a formation of helicopters. And, you know, then I'm looking at the lights, and as they're getting further and further apart, the relationship between the lights never changed. They got further apart, but the individual distance between the lights always remained, so to speak, in the same relationship. They were perfectly even. They didn't move up or down. And I'm saying, wow, if this is a formation of aircraft, who's ever flying this, I don't know how they're staying so tight in formation. So as it got closer and closer and the lights were further and further apart, I began to think, well, maybe this is, you know, some kind of object, and that it had to be pretty big. When it was about just a couple miles away, we're watching it, all of a sudden, I caught the image of what it was. I could see its outline. It was almost the same exact color of the sky, but because it was passing over stars, the stars were being blocked out and then come back after it passed. And it looked like an actual very geometric carpenter square, like an equilateral triangle without the bottom. And in each arm were two lights evenly spaced, and in the very tip was one single light. And these lights were perfectly round and perfectly white light. The tip of this thing was like sharp as a tack, and the two tail ends were squared off perfectly. As it came closer and closer, we realized that it was coming straight at us. It was going to come right over us. And for some reason, I don't know how it happened, but it seemed to have dropped down in altitude. And now it was literally coming down the street. And the kids, as they saw it, they started jumping up and down because it was going very, very slow. And it looked like, hey, this thing is going to come over us and stop. And every jump they took, when they landed, they were one jump closer to running in the house. So now I'm standing there. Now I walked over in front of right on the edge of the street, looking up at this thing go by, and I'm looking at the outer edge of this wing, and I could see way down the block, 600 feet away. I couldn't actually see the tail. I saw the third light, and it's going by. The outer edge of this thing was so perfectly straight, dark, almost the same color as the sky, but you could see the stars, and then you couldn't see the stars. And as it's going by, it wasn't fluttering at all. It was so smooth, it almost looked like a computerized graphic. The kids out in the middle of the street said, "Hey, look up inside, in between the two arms." And looking at the stars inside, they looked like some kind of distortion, not a heat distortion. It just did not look as clear as the stars on the outside. He's actually out in the street running after this thing. That's how slow it was going. The kids thought it was going about 10 or 15 miles an hour. And this last light came down, and Bobby and I were just standing there, and it went right over us, and it looked like this big circular hole of pure white light. It looked like beyond fluorescent, almost like little particles of light, and the light was stuck up inside. It was almost like it was being held inside. There was no glass on it, and there was no light that I noticed around us on the ground, but it was really, really, really bright. Then the tail end of this thing went by like that, and I saw very absolute sharp-edged went by, and as it did, the stars unfolded after it. We live up on about 1,200 feet above sea level. We're in a little valley above Phoenix, and surrounded by this valley are like little mountain peaks. And there's this two peaks, and in the middle of it, a little hill. This thing went right through the crack in the mountain. It flew right through there. It didn't go over the top. It just barely fit. It kind of was in such a way now it was tilted. It was probably just going straight, because now I could see the lights from the backside underneath. It went out straight over towards the airport, right to the right side of Squaw Peak. And then I lost the lights in the whatever lights were flying around in the atmosphere disturbance or whatever. So when I saw this technology, I know there's nothing on this planet like that. There's no capacity to fly a craft. It wasn't even flying. How could something fly, be lifted by air, going that slow? Not possible. Not possible whatsoever. This thing was not flying. It was cruising with some kind of ability, I don't know. It was absolutely perfect, under control, powerful, smooth, quiet. And I looked at that and I said to my wife, whoever's got this technology is in cahoots with God. Hal, why don't you tell?
We were freaking out because we had, like, in 1996 is when Independence Day came out, and I was 10 years old. So when you see Independence Day and then you see this, like, craft, like, coming over your house, you kind of, you know, get a little scared, because it's like, is it going to stop? Are we going to be the people underneath going, oh, no? You got those chills in the back of your neck where you get all goosebumpy and your hair stand up on end. The point at which we started getting excited was after it had gone about halfway over, and basically we got the feeling that it was just going to keep going, which was much of a relief, you know, that it wasn't going to stop. Because if it did, I don't know what we'd do, just go, okay. That's when we were like, you know, oh, let's go after it, you know. So we just literally start running down the street. Dad, come on, get in the car, chase it. And he was just like, no. And he was just looking at it, and we're like, oh. And my nephew Damien said that he probably could have thrown like a tennis ball or a rock up and hit it. It was that close. At the time, there was this house that was being constructed up on the hill, and there was a telephone pole, and the craft flew, like, right over the top. There was no sound, like, even in the neighborhood was really quiet. Like, the only sound that there ever was that there was a small, you know, just like a small propeller plane that flew over the top of it, pretty high up. It looked like this big in comparison. That was the only sound at any point.
When Hal came to get me in the house, and I was cooking dinner, he just told me that there were lights outside. And so I went running out the door looking at the lights over the mountain. I saw the lights then, you know, at that point, and I sat with them and watched them just exactly as Tim described. When it was coming up towards us, and it seemed like it was very high, and I could see it just as clear as a bell, that it was shaped, what I said at the time, was like a carpenter square. It looked like a flying carpenter square. All of a sudden, you know, we It seemed like I either looked away and I blinked and it was, you know, right upon us and then coming right down the street. And as it left, and Tim and I were looking up into the light wells, I mean, these were circular light wells that were, we could not even estimate really how deep they were, since we didn't know exactly how far away it was. But the lights looked like they were at least 15 feet, you know, wide. And I don't know how deep, because all we could see was the white light inside the wells. And then as it proceeded over the mountain, just missing the tops, like Hal said, I looked at the lights in front of it, you might say, because I wanted to see if I could see the top of it. And as it was going through, I could see a slight mound to the point, you know, which would have been the front end of it. It just seemed like a very thin craft. When the right arm was coming over the house, we were looking at it, and I was looking at the left arm, and it just went completely over towards the mountain. That I made a comment then. I said, oh my God, how big is this thing? Because it just seemed to cover the whole entire neighborhood. You know what I said as it went over after seeing that little plane? I said, you could fit 10 stealths on one arm.
I guesstimated that it was each arm was about 700 feet, and if it was an equilateral triangle in a sense, then the distance between the tails would have been about 700 feet. When we talk about this, people get picky and they say, well, you know, was it 200 feet? Was it 182 feet away? Is it 12 feet wide? You know, et cetera. Listen, it was freaking huge. It was going really slow. It had these big lights in it. It didn't make a sound. That's the point. It was there. We saw it. There's no doubt in our minds whatsoever what we saw. My wife and I work. He goes to school. That's our lives. We're normal folks. We're nothing special.
Well, you know, when it first happened, I think we were so awestruck by the whole event. We didn't forget, but we didn't know what to do. You know, it was like, you know, I had already, by then I came back in, we all came back in, and we were talking about it, and then we all kind of got silent. And we were all sitting at the table, and this was, you know, Hal, Tim, and Damien, our grandson, who was then 14, and myself, and we didn't know what to even say to one another. You know, we were just kind of like sitting there. And then we said, what do we do? You know, I mean, who do we call? You know, we didn't know what to do. And so we didn't call anybody. Because, well, you have that stigma, you know, it's like...
you trust, you know, your family, and, you know, if we say we saw something, you know, then we did.
Sure, sure.
And, you know, they'll support us either way.
There was this kid that lived just a few blocks from me, and my stepson knew him. He brought the kid over to my house, and the kid did these drawings, and it was exactly what we saw. So I ended up going over to this kid's house, and meeting his father, and both of them described what we saw, but they saw it from like a couple blocks below. I personally, and I know they feel the same way, it doesn't matter to me whether you believe me or not. It doesn't. It only matters to you, because we know what we saw. We know what we have. You need to see that. You need to understand that. That's it. So that's where our attitude is at. So, you know, 10 years, nothing happening, and all of a sudden here we are talking about it. Fine, we'll talk about it. We'll tell you exactly what happened.